All right. Woo. All right, JD, you can unmute yourselves and we are back.
Bravo. Happy birthday, Mr. Right. Yeah.
Exceptional, very important album. If you guys know it already, you can go back to it, and every time you're going to listen to it, you're going to hear something new and get something new in you. So that's always a good album to go back to. All right, so let's welcome the new friend who joined us. We have Slava from Ukraine, Noah from the States. We have Bill from Brazil. Cool. So again, welcome everybody. For people who joined us, don't forget to write your comments in the comment box, your questions in the question box by clicking on the question mark. Okay, so let's dive in. We just heard Sonny Rollins, and for me, I mean, I hope you won't say otherwise, but for me, I hear a lot of I hear a lot of the tradition in your sound, JD. And Sonny Rollins is one of the sound that I hear a lot, not only the sound but also the playing as well, and other I can hear other people as well. Is that something you could confirm, or maybe not so much? You know, sometimes we can hear influences and the artist is not actually that much influenced by this name, but what is it for you?
Definitely Mr. Rollins is a huge influence for me, along with the other Titans, but I definitely check out Mr. Sonny Rollins for sure. That song in particular reminds me of, I'm from Detroit, Michigan, and there's a couple of Detroit musicians on that particular record from Detroit. And actually one, I think both Doug Watkins and Tommy Flanagan went to the same high school that I went to. Not at the same time, but Northwestern High. So that was a big deal going to that school, knowing that they went there. But I used to listen to that particular song, well, the whole album, on my way to high school. I used to catch two buses to school and two buses back, and I would have that song on repeat, just trying to figure it out, and it still sounds like magic. Although I know now that I'm older, I know it sounds like hard work and dedication, but it sounds like magic. So Mr. Rollins is definitely a major influence for me. Definitely, I listen to
him. Yeah, wow. That's funny, because I actually I was going to ask you, because I know, so you were born in Detroit, mm-hmm. and being from France, I can say that, you know, internationally, Detroit is known for the car factory, and you know, Detroit does not come necessarily first in terms of jazz scene. And when I moved to the States, and I realized that actually there is a lot of great musicians from Detroit.
Yeah,
and I didn't know that before, and so I wanted to ask you, what were maybe some of the musicians that were influential for you who were from Detroit, and maybe that you met or not?
Well, we gotta say definitely Barry Harris is definitely from Detroit, Michigan, and he's known for having a lot of students from Detroit that went on to change the world. Like I just mentioned, Tommy Flanagan and Doug Watkins, I believe, and Yusuf Lateef, as a youth, spent his time in Detroit and grew up in Detroit and became Yusuf Lateef in Detroit. A lot of great, Paul Chambers, a lot of great musicians. So, I mean, and then you have, on top of that, we have Motown Records, which is was down the street from my high school. The great thing about being from Detroit is the fact that a lot of great musicians came from that town. And some of them, quite a few of them, had moved to New York. There were some that still stayed in Detroit. So my connection to maybe the Barry Harris thing is with his students that stayed in Detroit. So I was fortunate enough to get some of that information. I still need to go, and I am presently going back and understanding it a little more. But that's been the influence from the Detroit connection. But you have to also take into consideration that Detroit was a migration city. A lot of people from the South migrated there because of the car factory. So it's a blue collar town in some sense. And so it was a major force in the world for quite a while, you know. So yeah. I'm proud to be from there. And the city is influential to me, period. You know, not only the music, a lot of things, you know.
Cool. All right. Cool. So let's talk a little bit about your new album. I was looking, and that's actually your 14th album as a leader.
Yeah. Wow. 14.
So JD, it's called Toys Die Dreaming. Uh-huh. Can you explain the title?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't.
Because those are two tracks from the album. There's one track called Toys and yeah. one track, Die Dreaming. So why the title is Toys Die Dreaming?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't count on the world changing like in such a way. So I know that was probably I was a little apprehensive about putting it out with a title like that, with the word Die Dreaming. But actually, Die Dreaming is actually a popular drink in the Dominican Republic. It's a drink called Die Dreaming, but when you taste it, it has nothing to do with that. You know, actually, it's very effervescent, and you know, so it was kind of a play on words, you know. So I just wanted to be not so serious as the previous album, Barracoon, which has a very serious topic and content and titles that have a lot of real density to it, feeling wise, and I hope playing wise. So it was my attempt at being not too serious and having fun at what people might think the title means. But I had no idea that COVID-19 would take place. So now it's taking on a whole another idea, and I have a whole another framework with it. So that's what it is, Toys Die Dreaming. Yeah.
All right. Okay, and so tell us so it's a trio album, and you've been recording in a trio format you did a few albums already in this trio.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I look at it as no longer as a novelty thing. Not that it was a novelty thing that Mr. Rollins and Ornette Coleman, Mr. Coleman did. It isn't novel, but I think now it's not a situation where it's such a oh wow, we're doing this thing with trio. It's a sound that I think is now a little more acceptable than maybe even 15 years ago. So go ahead,
brother. Those are new musicians from the previous trio album.
Uh huh.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. New. This is from the previous album, Barracoon, spilled over into Toys Die Dreaming. Yeah. Two very different sounding albums.
Yeah.
At least that was the goal, you know.
Yeah. All right. Okay, so I wanted actually to, I know I realize that's going to be two tracks to listen before we actually listen to you, but in a way I'm building up the building up the desire for people to
lead the dance. I'll follow, no problem.
I'd like to, because the opening track is You're My Thrill.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a old standard. Mm-hmm. And your version, and that's not the first recorded version of yours, but no. Your version in this album is very different from your previous version and mm-hmm. from the standard version. So I would and I asked you before what was your favorite version, and so you told me Billie Holiday. So I'd like to listen to Billie Holiday, and so. So that we can hear your version. I mean, the version that you like the most, and then your version from your new album, and finally your version from the previous album. So I know we're going to, but I think this is interesting because we're going to listen to You're My Thrill three times in a row, but very different, in a very different style. So here we go. And again, JD, if I can just ask you to mute yourself.
Sure. No problem.
You're something to me. You send chills right through me. When I look at you, 'cause you're my thrill. You're my thrill. How my pulse increases. I just go to pieces when I look at you, 'cause you're my thrill. Nothing seems to matter. Here's my heart on a silver platter. Where's my will? Why this strange desire that keeps mounting higher when I look at you? I can't keep still. You're my. That keeps mounting higher when I look at you. I can't keep still. You're my.
All right. So, Jenny, could you tell why this version is your favorite? What does it mean for you?
It's a beautiful tune. I really love the lyrics. I got more familiar with the lyrics when I was working on the ballad record, Love Storm. And I just really love the way she sings. I mean, I'm a big Billie Holiday fan, so I had another way that I wanted to try it again. And not to improve on it, but, you know, you play things and you say, okay, I have another idea, so I decided to record it again. But it's simply a beautiful song with many different versions that I heard. That's my favorite version, but every other version I've heard is so different from each other, so I just wanted to give it another try. You know?
All right. Speaking of the lyrics, how, on which side of the spectrum are you? Some people say you cannot play standard if you don't know the lyrics. Some people say, yeah, I don't care about the lyrics. Where are you?
I'm in the middle with that. I mean, I think it's important to know the lyrics so you can know what you plan about. You know, you take it to them, like everything happens to me. When I look at the lyrics, not that I remember all of them, but it was just so funny that I had something totally different in my mind than what the lyrics were actually talking about. But I think that this particular song, You're My Thrill, I think it's good to know what that's about, you know. Now, what in terms of phrasing, you know, because the lyrics go with the melody in terms of phrasing it. But I'm in the middle with that. Like, you know, if a great melody is a great melody, and the lyrics are like the champagne, that the bubbles from the champagne, you know, so it works.
All right. Okay, let's listen to your version from your new album. And can you tell us a little bit, how did you come up with this arrangement? What was a little bit like your creative process for this version?
Oh, well, I tried it obviously in 4/4, and I decided to give it a shot in 3, and I like to call it a church 3/4, like a 6/8 feel. And I think the thing that made it work, or at least this version a little bit closer to working, was the fact that I told Ian and Nick, Ian Kinsler, my bassist, and Nick Kachoko, my drummer, in the studio to think of a Sufi dervish where they dance in circles like that and have that feel in mind. So when I said that, I feel like they had that picture in their mind of a dance of a dervish. This is what came out. This worked, you know, for the time being, you know. So, and then I just elongated the A form, you know. Simple as that. Not too much.
Right.
A couple of tricks.
Okay, cool. So let's listen to that. And guys, let us know in the comments what are your feelings when you're listening to this version. What do you feel? What do you think? What images maybe come in your mind? Anything that you want to say when you hear this version that we're going to see is very different from a standard version. All right. Beautiful.
Ooh. Oh, thanks.
Yeah, that was intense, huh? You guys, did you guys feel that there was a dervish, the dancing dervish? That's interesting because, I mean, for again, I don't want to get too technical in this this today because this is for more like the general jazz fan, but maybe we'll get to talk a little more in detail about this when we'll do the workshop with my students.
Oh, cool.
Because you say, you know, you mentioned it was more of a 6-8 feel and rather than a 3-4. And that's a detail, but that changes a lot in the way the music is played. All right.
I like to call the 6-8 the black 3-4.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, that's what I like to call it, you know. So, you know, with that in mind, you know, things happening in between the beats. I'm not going to get too technical with that.
Yeah. No, but that's interesting because actually that's exactly what we've been talking about with my students this year. So that would be very great. Guys, just a little parenthesis. I put JD's Facebook page link. So if you're interested, please follow him on his Facebook page. JD, you're not too much in the internet thing. You don't have your own website, right?
Yeah, I won't say I've given up on that, but I think you know, when people want to find you, they'll find you. You know, I really believe that. I have nothing to sell. There's a product to be sold. I do believe in if you're gonna do something and someone hires you to do something, or if you make an agreement with someone, my job at this time is to compose and write the music. I am not the baker, the candlestick maker, and things like that. I do what I do. So, I don't have much of a digital imprint, but people seem to find me. So, you know, that's where I'm at right now. You know?
That's good.
I'm not in a rat room for everybody, you know. I can see my aunt saying, "No, JD, don't say that." But that's pretty awkward.
All right. So before moving on to the version from your previous album, I wanted to ask you a question I received for you. And sure. It's Patrick who asked, usually, how does inspiration come to you? It's very broad.
It comes from reading titles, newspapers, movies, other type of art forms. Just things like that. I mean, here's a book I'm rechecking out again. It's, I don't know if you can see it, The Mysticism of Sound and Music. I don't know if people, that's something that I read maybe 15 years ago. So I'm rereading that now. I mean, I have a chess book, you know, that's inspirational to me. I mean, I like to read, you know. Now, do I finish every book? No. But I have about 10 books that I go in between, you know. So it could be a title, something as simple as a title, you know. Yeah. And then I imagine a soundtrack to whatever I come across. You know, something like that.
All right. Yeah. And let's see, a few comments about the recording. Lionel mentioned it makes him think about Coltrane Africa Brass Session. And he's asking if you have any Archie Shape influences.
Of course, yeah, definitely. I like to think that I try to capture everyone's thing as much as possible. Because I don't think it's about being original. I think it's, of course, you have no choice but to do your own thing. But I think that we are made up of many different things, just like parents. You know, we come from a mother biologically and a father, and we're a mixture of those two DNAs, and that makes us. So that's how I look at music. So yeah, I'm Archie Shepp. Mr. Shepp is definitely in there, along with Ornette Coleman or Albert Eiler. You might not readily hear that, but he's someone that I've checked out. So yeah, Archie Shepp is in there, I'm sure.
Cool. What about Dexter Gordon? For me, I didn't hear too much of Dexter in that particular track, but definitely in some other tracks.
Oh yeah,
I hear like, okay, Dexter, Dexter is in the house.
Yeah, I mean, well, you know, I think whether we know it or not, all modern tenor saxophone goes back to Dexter Gordon. And then you get into the other titans, you know, but Dexter Gordon is a big influence on us all, whether we know it or not. If you, you know, I like to think if you love John Coltrane, Mr. Coltrane and Mr. Sonny Rollins, then you definitely love Dexter Gordon, which means you would love Lester Young and Coleman Hawkins and Charlie Parker. And it's all connected, you know. So yeah, Dexter Gordon is in there, definitely.
All right, let's have a listen to You're My Thrill again by you again. Oh, yeah. Very, very different take on it. And it's from the album Love Stone. Thank you.
you want to do it over again. I'm like,
beautiful. Man, it's funny because as I was listening, I heard all those, all those sax players from the history. And it's funny because often you hear, oh, okay, this guy is, you know, like very, you can hear like one or two major influence in a musician, whether that's a sax player or a pianist or, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. But it's funny, like sometimes, and depending on your register, like if it goes in the high register, sometimes make me think of somebody, and then in the low register, it makes me think of somebody else. And it's really, I just come back to that because that's very, very particular to your playing. And for me, I say that as a compliment.
I take it as a compliment.
just to make sure that I'm not.
No, you're spot on. No, I mean, I really believe that you should have a musician should have five or six bags, not meaning that you're not being yourself, but you take, it's like, it's the same concept as building a quilt. You know, you take a piece from this clothing and this, and then you put it in this creation, and then it's yours, you know what I mean? And then you could, you just take pieces here and there, you know? So that's the way I was taught, you know, it's not to shy away from your influences, but to learn from them and make them your own. And in trying to do that, you develop your thing along with the lineage, you know? So it gives it roots and, you know, and depth, you know? That's how I was taught anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and I think we could do we could give a saxophone history lesson based on your sound, because like sometimes I hear like the sound in the low register makes me think of Dexter, then maybe in the high register I hear Lester Young, and some rhythmic playing from Sonny Rollins.
Yeah.
Then some vocabulary, more culturing, you know. So it's really, for me, it's I really, really love it.
Oh, you called me out. Guilty. the gig is up. Yeah, that's really, yeah.
all right. I want to keep on with another track from your new album, Toys Die Dreaming. And this track is the G thing. Yeah. Before that, can you? I see your every, but the cover of this new album is very nice, and you have a beautiful photo of yourself on a love stone. How do you? What was the creative process on that part? Like the cover.
I usually work, well, for the most part, most of the records that I do, and I like to think that she's also a part of the band. I work with a designer by the name of Rebecca Meek, and I never tell her what to do. You know, I never say, I want this, or this is my idea. I give her the music, and I give her the reason behind it, and then I just let it go. And whatever she comes up with, I accept, you know. So that's been our partnership in terms of the album covers, and including this one also. I had no idea what it was going to be. I didn't say. I told her what was intended behind it, and then the world changed, and I guess this is how she felt. So I have my interpretation of it, and as a lot of people have many different interpretations of this particular album cover, but it's not something where I say, I want this. You know, I keep people around me, and I let them be creative in the process. They join me.
All right, because you know, that's the picture in itself is very beautiful.
For definitely for this one, not the one with me. That's supposed to be, you know. I guess I'm the stone in that one. I don't know. You gotta ask them that. But this one, I think for this, I do feel that this particular album cover is a mirror of sorts to the, depending on who's looking at it, you get a different thing. You know, it's really interesting. Some of the responses that I've gotten, great, and some not so great. And sometimes it's been responses where I got a chance to see what the person actually really thinks. So it's been it's been an interesting process with looking at this cover. So it's a few different feelings about it. I enjoy it. You know, I see two children playing carelessly and a young black male smiling without care. And for some people, that's tough to take. And for some people, that's nice to take. There's a lot of things going on in this cover. So it means different things to different people.
Yeah, I mean, so, if we look at it, we see a young black kid, a white black kid, which probably is a girl.
Yeah, that's a
fair enough. And the American flag. I mean, so yes, it's, one could, you know, go into
and depending on how I feel when I wake up, when I look at it, I have a different feeling for it. But I think that's cool when you can look at a mirror and you can get a judge of where you're at in this world. So bravo on this cover. You know, I was I was surprised and had questions in it for myself. But I thought that, you know, at this point in time, it's cool to, it's interesting to put out and see what people respond, how people respond to it.
Very that's cover. That's a beautiful cover. Is it Rebecca took the picture?
Rebecca Meek, she has all the information. She sought out the photo, did the cover design and everything. So I have nothing to do with that. Like I said, I tell her what the album is about or what it isn't about. And I just usually for the past 14 years, I've left the creative process up to her. And I don't question
it. So on your albums.
She's done the majority of my recordings and the working relationship has been, I tell her what it's about, what I was thinking, maybe what I was reading, and then I just let it go from that point. And that's been our working relationship. And, you know, whatever is decided, I just say, okay, well, that's what you think. That's what we're going to do. And I've usually been very happy with that process. You know, it's almost a part of the music at that point. You know, it's not complete until, you know, she does her thing. So it's cool. It's cool to have creative friends, you know.
All right, cool. Well, let's listen to the G thing. What is the G thing?
The G thing. It could be a lot of things. I mean, in truth, the G thing is what my bassist Ian Kinslar said, because we didn't have a working title for the song, and he said, "Oh, the G thing." You know, so, oh, I like that. You know, so depending on what neighborhood or part of the world you're in, G can be a lot of things. God thing, good thing, the whatever thing, you know. So that's the G thing, you know.
All right.
But it's the key of the song originally. That's the key and contra key of the song. Is the G.
All right. Thing, yeah. All right. Let's listen to that.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
All right. The G-Fing. And for the members of Jazz Video Lessons, we will talk about that particular tune during our session with JD, which will be September 21st, if I remember correctly. Yeah. All right, great. I want before moving on to the last tune of today, I want to go to a couple of questions. I received a question. Someone was interested in knowing how did you get started with the saxophone and kind of how was your evolution as a young person into jazz.
I still try to remain a young, wise person now, but the start was I actually started singing when I was 9 with my 2 sisters. Realized that I couldn't sing, and I started out on the clarinet at 9 years old. Switched to saxophone at the age of 14. I have a very close aunt, sister, that introduced me to jazz. She called it progressive music. And that started me on my journey with trying to figure out what the hell is progressive music. Just so happened, I met some young people my age, around the age of 14 to 15 years old. And I got into a band when I was 15 or 14 years old with Rodney Whitaker, a great bassist in Detroit, Michigan. And started playing professionally at 15 years old, and been about it ever since. But I like to think that I did take some private lessons from James Carter around that age. But at 18 years old, I took some classical saxophone lessons that kind of grounded me in terms of the saxophone. And a lot of those things that I got from those lessons with a teacher by the name of James Nesbitt. I still practice some of those fundamentals today. So it's, you know, I think I get a little better every year. You know, I improve a little bit every year. And that's how I like to think, that it's a year process to getting better, you know? So that's basically in a nutshell, you know?
All right. Cool. I'm taking notes at the same time. All right, let me see. Oh, yeah. Someone asked, what's a typical day in J.D. Allen's life?
Currently?
I guess maybe let's do the pre-COVID thing and now.
Pre-COVID.
Until March. What was it? Day?
Well, I had actually gotten up to 6 hours a day of practice, actually. There were periods along the way where I would do that, but like I really had kind of like made it a schedule in terms of getting at least 4 a day. I had to do 4 a day. And it's something about when you hit the 4-hour mark, your phone starts to ring. And when I figured that out, I was like, oh, okay, so I got to hit 4 hours no matter what. Is that an hour in the morning, an hour here, an hour there? But it has to be, the goal was at least 4 or more. That was my motto pre-COVID. And I started seeing the positive aspects of that, of practicing as if it's a job, because it is a job, you know, when we're not on the stage. You have to look at it like that. I mean, there is a such thing as inspiration, but there is a such thing along with that, hard work. And so I had gotten to that point. Now, when COVID hit, I thought the world was over. So, you know, I still tried to practice, but it became much harder. So now my schedule is much different. Oddly enough, a lot of my time has been consumed with trying to learn how to organize for a new situation that's called We Insist. So I've been juggling that along with practicing. So now I get 3.5. Now I've gotten it back up to 3.5, and I'm still working on it, you know, to my 6-hour goal, or at least 4 or more goal. But it's a process. You got to work towards it. You know, it's not something that you could just do, you know. So that's what's going on with JD. That's a typical day with JD.
All right. You mentioned Wee Incense, and I wanted you to talk a little bit about this, how did you get involved? And while you do that, I'm going to put the link for people to check.
Yeah, sure. We Insist is an organization of musicians we would like to push Black Lives Matter issues and issues of patriarchy to the forefront. We just so happen to be concerned citizens, good neighbors who want to use our music and some of our thoughts and be a part of the discussion that's affecting everyone. So, it's a new organization, and we're forming alliances with people in the UK, in Chicago, LA, some South Africa and Ghana. So this is an organization that's we're deciding to come together and figuring out how we can work for the betterment of all, and also for the betterment of ourselves in terms of the touring circuit, where we can. It's basically going to be a union without saying the word union, and it's going to be something that's community based to help the community and actually find more kids who look like us to play music that started from their culture. So that's basically it in a nutshell. I'm really happy to be doing that. It's nice to put a purpose with the notes other than just trying to sound good, So that's our goal. Thank you for asking. I really appreciate that.
No, of course. And guys, you have the link right here. And you just click on the button, and that brings you to the website. Check it out. And support in any way you can this organization. Okay, we ask the typical day in JD's life. All right. Okay, I wanted to ask you about your experience with Baby Carter.
Okay.
Because you worked quite a bit with her.
Yeah, I mean, she brought me to New York City, definitely.
And so, can you share a little bit of this experience and what that means for you?
Great. Betty, Miss Carter had a program called Jazz Ahead. It wasn't something that I auditioned for. A very good friend of mine's auditioned for it by the name of Tarsili Bond. He was a bass player. He passed away now. And he asked me to perform on his audition tape. It was a cassette tape, actually. And so I played on it, and he got accepted. And she said, the saxophone player that's on it, I would like him to join the program also. So I had I was just trying to figure out what I was going to do. I wasn't quite sure. I left school. I needed to take a break, and I was trying to figure out some life issues, and that situation presented itself. And so she brought me to New York, and the Jazz Head program was, I would say, basically inner city kids around the United States or kids who were playing jazz brought all together for 2 weeks to compose and put on a show that Miss Carter had started. Usually it was at the Apollo or BAM Theater, and we would play, and she would recruit musicians from these programs. So I got recruited to join her band, and that was a hell of a process to play with a master musician and to deal with someone who actually saw the music take shape and was a contributor to the music was very important. So a lot of stuff that I learned from her, I try to implement in different bands that I work in. And even with this We Insist situation, it's kind of along the same lines of reaching out to the community and giving people an opportunity to change their lives, such as myself, So she's very important to me, and I'm very grateful to have met Ms. Carter,
Cool, beautiful. So yeah, indeed, she did kind of help you choose your path.
Oh yeah, definitely. The most beautiful part of it, and I'm not quite sure if people, it's kind of not something that would happen a lot. It happens in my groups, you know, like I tell my bands, I've told my bands that if I don't like it, I'm gonna let you know. And that's something that I was really appreciative. When you were on a stage with her, it was teaching in real time. So you had to have a develop a thick skin when someone is telling you to swing, motherfucker. You couldn't be afraid. You know, you had to push right into it, because it was it was my chance to get the oral tradition from someone who'd been around the greats. But she was very vocal in real time about what you should be doing. You know, so that was like, so appreciative of that, of learning this music that way. You know?
Nice.
Yeah. It was scary though, Alex. Very scary. I mean, you never knew when he was gonna get fired. The only time you knew he was gonna get fired was whenever she announced the band. She said, and joining us for his last performance, that's when he got fired. So he was always like, no, okay, is this it? You know. It was great, though. It was good. Made me tough.
All right, cool. Wow. Okay, and let's get a couple of questions we got from here. Let me get this. Okay. Jean-Paul say, I could detect the influence of Dexter Gordon in your tune Put on a Happy Face. Okay. On Love Storm. Am I right?
Yes. Once again, Dexter Gordon is definitely in that situation. I'm a stone cold Dexter Gordon fan, man. You know, I think you can put people in your playing through tone, and I think you can inhabit their being, not so much the. I have a different idea, a take on transcribing. I believe in learning the, along with the notes, but learning the inflections are just, and probably a little more important than the notes for me. So yeah, Dexter Gordon is in there. And once again, Mr. Rollins, John Coltrane, a lot of people, you know. So yeah, it's true. He's in there.
All right. Speaking of tone, Marco say exceptional tone, man. Would you mind sharing your setup?
Okay, yeah, no problem with there. But you know, I have to say tone is here, it's in the brain, you know, and if you have your sound in here, your tone is gonna come out in any mouthpiece, but a particular instrument or a tool is going to help you help that facilitate it more. So first and foremost, sound is here. Okay. So, but for these particular records, on Love Stone, I was using the Jody Jazz Giant, and I love that mouthpiece, a number 8 star Jody Jazz Giant. It's a aluminum mouthpiece, and it feels like a hard rubber. So it's pretty cool, because it can go in between both in terms of feel. And for this latest recording, I'm using a Soyos, I believe, Soyos, a number 10 star, and a two reed, you know.
On Toys Die Dreaming, you're using a Soyos.
Okay. Yeah.
10 star. Yeah. Okay, so very open.
Yeah.
Quite open. And yeah. it two reed. Which model of reed?
Oh, it's a Rico Select, I believe. Mm-hmm. Select, yeah. Two Saw, that's what it's called. 2S. And I used to try to play on hard reeds, and now I understand the importance of a very, very soft reed. You know, it gives you a little more flexibility, you know, especially with an open mouthpiece. You know, so I dance back and forth between the two. And I know, and I'm sure someone's gonna get mad that they're hearing this now. But let me say, in my defense, it's interesting to every 6 months my thing in sound changes to me. Maybe we all go through that, where you play your mouthpiece and you hear something different, or you want something different. So those two they seem to give me like what I want. So when it changes. But currently on this record, and currently I am using the Styles number 10, 10 star to read. I enjoy both mouthpieces. You know, I think they're brilliant. You know.
Cool. All right. Enough of the jazz geek, the saxophone right. geek moment. We're about to close. I want to finish with your song Daydreaming.
Okay.
First, I want to just like to save some time because we've been going for over an hour, and I appreciate you taking the time, JD. I just want people to listen to the beginning of Mr. Day by Coltrane, and then we'll listen to your song.
Okay.
And let's see if we catch the similarities.
All right.
All right. I hate to do that. It's very painful.
Yeah. Well, it's about to be very painful in a minute now.
No. It's always very painful to cut the track, but I have to do it because I don't want to take too much of your time again. I'm very appreciative, and also I know of people who are joining us. Okay, so now let's listen to Daydreaming, one of the title tracks of your album, Toys Daydreaming. And again, let us know in the comments if you hear the similarities. If you have any questions, now is the time to ask your questions before we finish, so we'll give you a few minutes to think about this while we listen to Daydreaming by JD.
We tried.
All right, beautiful. Jean-Paul say powerful.
Thank you.
All right, so if you guys didn't hear, go back and listen those two tracks and pay attention to the rhythm of the bass line at the beginning of the song, and see if you catch the similarities. The similarity is in the rhythm of the bass line. All right. All right. So, guys, I just want to remind you one more time that this is your chance, last chance to ask JD directly a question about his record, his new album, Toys Diet Dreaming, maybe music, life. JD, so I gave the link to your Facebook music page. If people want to reach out or get your album, what's the best way to get your album?
Well, the best way to get my album is iTunes, and, you know, all the mediums that we all are using to get these albums, and that is there. And
is it also available in LP as an LP and CD or
not yet? I was actually trying to do that, and that's still up in the air. I would love to make it an LP, but no, at this time, no, there isn't an LP for that. But there are talks about maybe that's going down. You know?
Is there a CD version or is it only digital?
There is a CD version on Amazon. You can get it there, or Barnes & Noble's, or all of the usual haunts that you would go to. I don't know, maybe Britney Spears. When you go look for your Britney Spears album, you can go J.D. Allen Trio and it pop up somehow, you know. But I'm actually, it's pretty, Spotify has it too. I see someone said that. But I'm very happy that there aren't a lot of music questions, because that's the goal. You know, these are fillings. And yeah, there is a smoke and mirror element to it, but it's cool that, you know, people are being very kind and saying they dig it, and that's what I do it for, is to share. So I appreciate this platform, Alex. I really, really do. Thank you.
No, my pleasure. It's a pleasure for me to. I got like many more questions for you, but I we gotta go.
By the way, I just want to say I really dig your your platform. I am a member of your school, and I go in there and I got my little notebook like everybody else, and I keep doing it, man. It's really nice to come across a fellow saxophonist with the wealth of knowledge and the warm heart to share it, man. Thank you for doing what you do, brother. I really appreciate that.
Yeah. And I'm honored. Well, thank you. It's my pleasure, and very, very happy and honored that you accepted to come and spend this time with us.
Of course. Yeah, come on. Yeah.
And so, guys, go check him out. Listen to his new album, Toys Die Dreaming, and the 13 album before that. That will keep you busy for a little bit.
I gotta make up for lost time, man. So that's what I'm doing. If I could do more, I would, believe me.
And if you can, if you find the CDs, you know, try to get the CD, or it's great. I mean, I can talk as a musician, it's great to have the Spotify and all the streaming to make the music available to a large amount of people. Unfortunately, the system is not very much in our favor in the financial side of the equation.
True.
In terms of streaming.
That's a whole other story right there.
Monica is asking if there will be a replay of this interview. Yes, Monica, the video V7 is being recorded. You will be able to, if you missed the beginning, you will be able to watch it again.
And that's actually my sister, Aunt Monica. That's my aunt. That's actually a family member, Monica. Hey, Monica, how you doing?
All right.
See, I told you she would be checking on me. You know? Oh man, that's funny.
Nice.
Yeah.
Some French people say that the CD is available, but they need to be a little patient on delivery for CDs because probably it's shipping from the US, I imagine. Okay. So but people have been able to purchase it from France on Amazon.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. Thank you for taking the time for looking for it too. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you.
Cool. All right. Okay, guys, thank you for tuning in. For members of jazzvideolessons.net, we will meet JD again on September 21st, Monday, September 21st, same time, 3 p.m. Eastern time. So check out your local time. In the meantime, I trust you guys to listen carefully to his music, because we will talk about his composition. He will share his composition, the G thing, with us, and his arrangement of You're My Thrill. So please be ready for this event, because again, this is a great opportunity for us to spend some time with JD. And one more time, JD, I really appreciate you taking the time to share all this with us. And yeah. On that note, be safe, everybody. Keep listening, keep practicing, and we'll see each other again very soon.
All right, ciao.
All right,
thank you.
Take care, everybody.
Everyone, be safe. Bye bye.